in this webinar. So he is professor in Université de Bordeaux, and he will talk about the boundary controlled heat equation as an exactly controllable system, quotation mark. Thank you, Marius.
Okay, thank you very much to all the organizers for this very nice initiative, and also for giving me the opportunity to make a talk towards such a large audience of specialists in control of PDEs. I have chosen a bit a provocative title for control specialists, since, of course, most of the people know, even if I will remind that, the heat equation is in general not a good example of exactly controllable system, due to what's well known as its regularizing effect. So the outline of my talk is as follows. I will first give some motivation, and I will recall quite in detail some background on reachability and controllability in general for linear systems, I would say. Then I will discuss with some details some new results for the 1D boundary controlled heat equation. And I will end up with some conclusions by stating some open questions. Let me go to the motivation and background. And in order to do that, I will go back to finite dimensional linear systems. So the most basic case in control theory. So in fact, I will discuss in particular finite dimensional, but I organize the material in such a way to be, let's say, possible to present it in a unitary manner for both finite and infinite dimensional systems. Schematically and even much more rigorously, finite dimensional and infinite dimensional well-posed linear systems can be represented as z dot is equal to az plus bu, where x is what's called the state space, u and a acts on this x, space x, u it's the input space or the control space, and b acts from u with value from capital U with values in capital X. And of course, in the case of finite dimensional control systems, we have X is equal to Cn and U is equal to Cn. Then what is assumed generally is that the operator A generates a strongly continuous semigroup on X. This semigroup becoming just an exponential family for finite dimensional control systems. In the infinite dimensional case, generally, A is not defined on the whole of X, is defined on a subspace called D of A and the domain of A. And here, if we endow it with a graph norm, it becomes a Hilbert space also, which is generally denoted by X1. And we also construct in a quite standard manner the dual of this X1 with respect to the pivot space X, and this is a construction which is useful to take in consideration what is called unbounded control operator, so which instead of going from U to X, as happens in the finite dimensional case, can go from capital U to X and X minus 1, which is a larger space, so they are called unbounded control operators. This is not just a generalization for functional analytic purposes. It is something which is necessary if we want to write into this framework systems with governed by PDEs with boundary control. Typically, boundary controls cannot be written as z dot is equal to az plus bu with b bounded from capital U to x. And the notion which is important is the notion of admissible control operator. So in general, after doing some extension of the semigroup and of the operator A, the state trajectory of the system will be written as a semigroup applied to the initial state plus an operator phi t applied to U, which is nothing else but a convolution of the semigroup with the bu. And generally, in the framework I just mentioned on my previous slide, this operator phi t goes from L2 of 0 infinity capital U to x minus 1. This allows us to give a definition, which is the definition of an admissible control operator, which are those operators for which the range of this operator is, in fact, in a smaller space, and more precisely in capital X. If this holds, we call this an admissible control operator. So if we look back to the formula, which is just above the definition, we see that the quantity which we are integrated with respect to time, the formula phi t u, lies for each sigma only in x minus 1. But happily, in many situations of interest, the integral from 0 to t is smoother in a certain sense, and it will lie in capital X. Many examples of PDEs fit into this framework. A pretty abstract example, which corresponds to the parabolic case, to an abstract parabolic situation, is the case where the semigroup generator is minus A0, where A0 is a self-adjoint and strictly positive operator. Then we can introduce the fractional powers of A0. And if B goes from U to X minus 1 half, so it is unbounded, but not too much, it could be allowed to go up to X minus 1. But if you go up to x minus 1 half, then it will be admissible. This is not at all difficult to prove. So this, for instance, is a case which can be used for the heat equation with boundary control. Now, what about controllability, which is an important concept in system theorem? So in system theory, in infinite dimensional setting, there are several notions of controllability. Exact controllability, all of them, so or at least all those which I will consider, can be defined in terms of the range of this operator phi tau. This range will be maybe the principal object of this talk. So this talk will be, in a certain sense, a talk about the range of phi tau. So AB is said exactly controllable if the range of phi tau is all of x. This coincides, it's easily checked, with the more usual definition in PDE community, which says that you can find controls which steer any initial state in x to any final state in x in time tau. Null controllability is defined as the property that range of phi tau contains the range of the semigroup at instant tau, so of t tau. This is easily checked to be equivalent to the existence for every initial state z0 in x of an input u, such that the solution of our state trajectory satisfies z of tau equal to 0. This justifies the term null controllability. Finally, approximate controllability means that the range of phi tau is dense in x. Obviously, these three concepts coincide with the usual controllability concept for finite dimensional linear time invariant systems. Let us now, up to now, everything was extremely classical. Just some remarks which are, let's say, very easy, but which I didn't see very much in, or sometimes not at all, in the literature. In the finite dimensional case, every linear time invariant system can be seen as a controllable one. Indeed, using the Kalman test, we can show that the range of phi tau is an invariant space of A. And the range of phi tau contains also the range of B. This means that if I denote by A tilde the restriction of A to range of phi tau, then A tilde B is a controllable, fast exactly controllable system, because we are in finite space dimensions. So this is a first remark, which is not, I think, very useful in the finite dimensional situation, but which somehow becomes much more interesting in an infinite dimensional context. I will come back to that. Also, if we take instead of inputs u, which are L2 functions with respect to time, we take inputs which are analytic functions from C to U, so which can be extended to analytic signals, also in the finite dimensional case, then the range of phi tau restricted to this space will be the same. So somehow what we are able to do with L2 signals coincides which we with what we are able to do with analytic signals. This is also a quite simple exercise of finite dimensional system theory. Well, in the infinite dimensional case, there is already quickly we see a simple situation where generically exact controllability will not hold. I'm coming back to my example with connected to abstract parabolic equation, FAS with A is equal to minus A0, where A0 is a strictly positive operator. And in the operator B, we have seen that if it goes from U to X minus 1 half, it is admissible, but it is more if it is slightly more than that, so it is compact, then AB will not be exactly controllable. This is also a pretty simple result, which is, for instance, in my textbook with George Weiss. Let us also mention that, unlike in the finite dimensional case, the restriction of A tilde of A to the range of phi tau is in generally with the same input operator B, not determining an exactly controllable system. We can give a counter example later on. So we see already immediate differences between the two situations. So why do we like exactly controllable systems? There are several reasons. I could mention, for instance, the fact that they allow good connections between controllability and inverse problems in a quite systematic way. I didn't write a slide on that. I just wrote a slide concerning the possibility of passing from linear to nonlinear problems. So I will be a bit more vague here. So if I consider a semi-linear control system, so the form z dot is equal to az plus some nonlinearity f of z plus bu, and I assume that ab is exactly controllable, and f is in an appropriate sense super linear. So typically there is a power there larger than one. In this situation, it is often, but of course, the approach needs to be adapted to the particular nonlinear problem considered. But very often, it is not difficult to obtain from the controllability of the linear problem the local exact controllability of the nonlinear systems. The approach would be the following. Given an F, a kind of source term, in L2 of 0 tau x, we consider the control system z dot is equal to az plus this given small f plus bu. And we claim that this is exactly controllable. What does this mean? That I, given a final state, I can find a control u which steers z from the initial state 0 to the final state chosen. Why that? Because doing this is equivalent to the fact that phi tau u, where phi tau is that convolution term which I have defined previously, is equal to minus integral from zero to tau of t and x t minus sigma f of sigma d sigma. And since this integral is nothing else but an element of capital X and phi tau will be onto, this is the definition of exact controllability, we can find a control solving this equation. Then we denote by z index small f the corresponding control trajectory, and we look for a fixed map of the fixed point of the map f goes to capital F of z index small f. So this is something which works very well, for instance, for semi-linear wave equation or for more complicated problems, with one restriction: f, capital F, needs to be superlinear, and of course we need the exact controllability of the linearized problem. So this provides a quite systematic approach. This, of course, will not work in general if we have just null controllability. There are ways to avoid the difficulty, but why doesn't it work as written here for null controllability, for null controllable system? Because the integral we have in the right-hand side, in the right-hand side of the equation, does not lie in general in the range of the semigroup. Because there is an integral there, and when sigma is close to tau, a problem may occur. So one of the interests of having exactly controllable system is to go somehow easier to nonlinear problems. Another one is to tackle in a more systematic way inverse problems. And I think that many other aspects could be, simplified by treating a system as an exactly controllable one, provided that we have chosen the right state space. Now, there are connections between null controllability and the reachable space. I will mention here one of them, which goes back to Fattorini and Zeidman. And this proposition 3 says that if AB is null controllable in any time, then the range of phi tau does not depend on time. So this is a very interesting property, which at least in the proof of Zeidman, which is briefly described here, but I will not insist on that. It's extremely simple. You can look at the slides when I will send them. It takes only two slides, and so it's quite easy to check. Fattorini's original proof was a bit more complicated, and it was somehow specific to the heat equation, but in fact this has nothing to do with a specific case. It's just a consequence of the null controllability in any time. Another remark connecting null controllability with a reachable space is that, in fact, we can diminish, in a certain sense, the admissible inputs. For instance, taking inputs which divided by t power alpha still lie in L2 of 0 tau u, and we get the same reachable space at the end, provided again that AB is null controllable in any positive time. In fact, here the proof is even simpler. It's roughly speaking, since our system is null controllable in any time, we can begin at any moment. So we can take controls which are zero at the beginning, and then they go to the target, and we reach finally the same set. So such controls which are zero on a neighborhood of zero, of course, they lie in the space curly u tau alpha, which I wrote here in blue. So this is a very simple remark, but which turned out to be essential for the proofs which are coming, which are slightly more complicated ones. Let us now go to the basic example, which is 1D boundary control the heat equation. So the boundary control heat equation will be on the segment 0 pi with two boundary controls, heat equation on 0 pi, with two boundary controls at x equal to 0 and at x equal to pi. These controls are denoted by u0 and u pi. And we take initial state is equal to 0, and then the input to state map corresponding to the system is the map to which to u0 u pi associates the value of the solution w at instant tau. So what can you say about the range of this operator? Well, there is a generic answer which I could have given in the abstract setting. It will be a norm space where I just, let's say, transport the norm from U2, from L2 of 0 tau capital U. Here capital U is C2. It's very simple in this case. So there are some questions which are also generic. The first one, especially, is this a Banach space? The question would the answer will be yes in this case, and it can be a more general one. The answer is yes as soon as our system is approximately controllable, which we know is the case here. And the second case, a second question, which is normally specific to each example. It's how can we give a simple characterization of the range of this operator? As I mentioned, possible applications are to nonlinear problems. This is an approach, an idea which has been used with a slightly different approach in a recent work of Laurent and Rosier. And also it can be very interesting for time optimal control problems. But in this case, what we need is not the range of phi tau when applied to L2 in time inputs, but to inputs which are L infinity with respect to time. And this is still, even for the heat equation, a problem which is not completely understood. What has been known on this problem? What goes back practically to Hermann there, and maybe even earlier, is that the range of phi tau is contained in the set of functions. So here you have, in this picture, you have the segment 0 pi. And on the segment 0 pi, we constructed the red square, which is denoted by capital D. So what is easy, it's not difficult to check, it's classical, let's say, is that every function in range of phi tau is holomorphic in this set capital D, or more precisely can be extended to a function which is holomorphic on this set capital D. So this is a classical PDE result. We are more interested in the opposite inclusion, so at least let's say control theorist became interested in the opposite inclusion, so find the largest possible subspace of range of phi tau. And already in the classical paper of Fattorini and Russell, it has been shown that the range of phi tau contains all the functions which are holomorphic in a strip, in a certain horizontal strip, and which have derivatives of even orders which vanish at x equal to 0 and of x equal to pi, which is a bit strange as a condition because we are controlling from the boundary. There is no reasonable reason to reach only functions which vanish at the ends of the interval. Much more recently, Martin Rosier and Rouchon have shown that every function which is holomorphic in a certain ball, strictly larger than the square, strictly containing the square capital D, can be reached by means of inputs, which are not only, in fact, L2, but which lie in a Jevray class, so which are very smooth, not analytic, but not far. Even more recently, Sylvain Hervé-Dosa and Jérémy Dardet have shown that as soon as a function is holomorphic in a neighborhood of this set D, which I call D epsilon, then it is reachable by controls which are L2. And in fact, looking to their construction, we may assume that they can do the same with smoother inputs. Another work, which is, let's say, came a bit after, is due to Andreas Hartmann, Karim Kielé, and myself, and says that the range of phi tau is sandwiched between two spaces of analytic function, so between the space A2 of D, which is called a Hardy Smirnov space, and the space A2 of D, which is called a Bergmann space. Of course, not everybody is familiar with these spaces, so I will define that on the next slide in a very simplified way. So the definition of the Hardy Smirnov space E2 is, with some regularity assumption on the set omega, the set of the functions which are holomorphic in omega, such that the trace on the boundary is L2 of the boundary, whereas the Bergmann space with a weight omega is the space of functions which are holomorphic inside omega and which are square integrable with weight omega in the surface domain omega, in the two-dimensional domain omega. So the Bergmann space is clearly larger than the Hardy Smirnov space, at least in the case omega equal to one, when the weight is taken equal to one. So this is this was the first, connection between these Hilbert spaces of analytic functions, which are basic concepts in complex analysis, basic spaces in complex analysis, and the reachable space of the heat equation. So let me now give the newer results. So the part which was not completely satisfactory was that we had just a double inclusion. We would have preferred to have an equality, and we didn't get it from the first try. In fact, the equality was hidden in our proof, and we were not able to see it carefully enough. So it took some time to realize that, and I will now present the results which give an equality of range of phi tau with a Hilbert space of analytic functions. These Hilbert space of analytic functions are not, at least in our approach, so standard, very standard ones. This has been, in a certain way, made more precise in a recent work of Hartmann and Orsoni. But let us first give the results in our setting. To state this, we define two infinite sectors. So delta is a sector between the two, orange lines. So it's an infinite sector between the two orange line, whereas delta tilde is P minus delta. And the intersection is the set D, which is a square D, which already appeared in our statements. We also need to introduce some weights, which are defined on these infinite sectors, which will be omega zero delta of S. So it's an exponential weight, which is very large on the real axis. and which is a constant on the boundary of delta. And similarly, omega pi delta of S is a symmetric weight. And we define a family of spaces indexed after the parameter delta larger than zero as the sum of these two Berman spaces. So A2 of delta with the weight omega zero delta plus A2 of delta tilde with omega pi delta. As every sum of Hilbert spaces and more generally of Nord spaces, I can define a norm on that, is which is the usual norm on a sum space. This norm will play an important role in the remaining part of this presentation. So the main results which we have obtained in a recent work with Karim Kelle and Thomas Norman are the following. For every tau larger than zero, the range of phi tau is equal to x delta, provided that delta is small enough. So tau does not, in the proof, let's say, which I will briefly discuss after, tau also needs to be small, but we know that since the heat equation with boundary control determines an exactly controllable, a null controllable system, we know that the range of phi tau does not depend on tau. So there is no smallness condition on tau. Then there is a complex analytic result, which is also in the same work, which says that xt is equal to x tau for every t tau larger than zero. This is a very strange result if we look a bit, because there is an obvious inclusion between all these spaces. And even between each term of the sums which define xt and x tau. And these inclusions for the terms are strict. However, when we take the sum, we have an equality for every t and tau. So this shows that this sum is a quite complex object. Putting together theorem one and proposition one, we obviously get that the range of phi tau is equal to x delta for every tau and delta larger than zero. So here we have a quite precise equality, which gives us the reachable space for every time tau. Next, we have also shown that somehow we can go to delta to infinity, and that x delta is so, which makes formally the weight disappear, and we get that x delta is equal to a2 of delta without any weight plus a2 of pi minus delta of delta tilde. Again, putting together theorem one, proposition one, and corollary and proposition two, we get that the range of phi tau is equal. So here, no need of delta in the last corollary two. The range of phi tau is for every tau larger than zero, the sum of A2 of delta plus A2 of delta bar. Let me mention that this equality has been obtained in 2019. By Marco Orsoni, by a direct approach. So without passing by these spaces XT, which we have previously defined. Let me give some ideas on the proof of this result, of the theorem one. So let me go back. This is theorem one. It says that the range of phi tau is equal to X delta, provided that delta is small enough. So in fact, I will take a departure point as a departure point a result which was implicitly contained in our first paper with Andreas Hartmann and Karim Kelley, which is that phi tau of square root of t times L2 of 0 tau, which is a smaller space than L2 of 0 tau, is equal to x tau. And this is completely contained in that work. And in fact, it has been obtained among other ingredients by using the fact that the Hardy Smirnov space E2 of D is included in the sum of the two weighted Bergmann space A2 of delta of omega 0 tau and A2 of delta tilde omega p tau. So in a certain way, what we're looking here is to the a very particular case what is called in complex analysis separation of singularities and Cousin problem. So the idea is that if you have two open sets, omega 1 and omega 2, and a space of holomorphic expansion, which functions, which can be all the holomorphic functions, but also a Bergmann space, a Smirnov space, denoted by tilde all of omega 1 and tilde all of omega 2, the question, which is called the separation of singularities in other contexts, Cousin problem, is do we have the equality of whole of omega 1 plus whole of omega 2 with the space of functions which are holomorphic in the same sense, with the same integrability condition, let us say, on the intersection omega 1 cap omega 2. This has been studied in various cases with very deep results, but it was open in the Bergmann case. Recently, Hartmann and Orsoni have obtained that this separation of singularities holds also for Bergmann spaces in a quite large geometric setting, which includes, in particular, the case of the sets delta of delta tilde, which we have written above. So, but this is not an we did not at all use this in our approach. So we used theorem 2, and then from theorem 2 things became very simple, because so u tau cap 1/2 is the same thing as square root of t times L2 of 0 tau, and since we have seen in one of our abstract results that for a system which is exactly controllable, not exactly controllable, null controllable in any time, we have equality of the range of phi tau restricted to the smaller space and all of range of phi tau, we have obtained that the range of phi tau is indeed equal to this x tau for every tau in zero delta star. And the remaining part is just obtained just using standard arguments. But in fact, the good equality, so let us remind that the final result is that the range of phi tau is equal to x delta for every tau and delta. In fact, this is completely true, but the good equality is somehow range of phi tau is equal to x tau, because this equality, we think, it's also an equality concerning the norms. It's not defines also in the norms on the two spaces seem to be equivalent, but we don't have a general proof of this. We'll have something as a partial result. Next, I will not go to that. We have shown proposition 1, which says that the spaces xt and x tau are the same, whatever are the values of t and tau. I will just mention that this is done locally and then by a continuation argument. So we define appropriate multipliers which allows to pass from xt and x tau. And finally, we use a lot the fact that x delta, let's say, it's independent of delta when delta is small. This is something we know already from the previous step. So I will not it's not a very complicated proof. It is essentially on this slide, but I will maybe omit it. So with that, so let me recall that in the first theorem we have shown that xt is equal to x tau, the range of vt is equal to x delta, for small delta, but with the fact that x delta does not depend on the positive value of delta, we get our final result. We also have by similar approach proved that the sum, the unweighted sum, is equal to the weighted sum for every delta. So I will again skip these proofs because it would be not easy to explain them on just a distance without a blank. Let me go to some concluding remarks and open questions. So, can we help exact controllability on the reachable space? We already mentioned that this holds in the finite dimensional case. But it does not hold in the infinite dimensional case. We can just take a heat equation on the half line and control from one end. And we see that the range of phi tau and the range of the semigroup, this is not a trivial result, but it's well known. For instance, Sylvain has a paper with a simple proof of that, that the range of phi tau and the range of t tau, so that the reachable space and the range of the semigroup, have in common only zero. So they are spaces which have nothing in common. So if you restrict the semigroup to zero, of course you'll get zero, but this is a completely trivial system. A more interesting question, which excludes the counterexample just mentioned, is does this hold for systems which are non-controllable in any positive time? Because what I previously said about the heat equation on a half line, control from the boundary, of course, implies that this system is not non-controllable, cannot be non-controllable. We don't know if the blue question has a positive answer. I would suspect that the answer in general should be no, but I don't have a counter example. However, in the case of our example, which is a 1D boundary control heat equation, this is almost true. If we take the restriction of the semigroup to this sum of 2x delta, it is not difficult to check that the semigroup will invariate this subspace. And of course, the range of phi tau contains the range of the semigroup. Since the range of the semigroup are functions which are analytic in the whole plane, which can be extended to analytic ones in the whole plane. Why I'm saying that it's only almost holding is that we don't know intriguing thing. Is the heat semigroup strongly continuous on range of phi tau endowed with its natural topology? Of course, the heat semigroup is continuous on L2. It is invariating range of phi tau, which is a very small subspace effect of L2. But we don't know if it is strongly continuous on this space. And strong continuity is part of our definition of a semigroup, is part of our definition of exact controllability. And also, it is not only an abstract need, but it's also, important when we want, for instance, to do a fixed point for a nonlinear problem. Another interesting question is, what is the reachable space when, instead of taking inputs which are only L2 functions with respect to time, they are functions which are smoother? Well, in this case, in fact, a very natural result holds. In order to have a trajectory which is much smoother, we need, of course, compatibility conditions for the control. So we need to take controls in the space appearing here in the third line, which is denoted by WN2 index L of 0 tau. So there are functions which are in the Sobolev space WN2 and which vanish together with their derivatives up to order N minus 1 at 0. So even in a classical context, these are necessary conditions to have more regular solutions when the initial state, I remind, is taken equal to 0. In this case, what we can prove, in fact, we can be much more precise than that, is that we can reach function in a certain Smirnov space, Smirnov type space, I would say even Smirnov Sobolev type space, which are the functions which lie in the Smirnov safe E2 of D with all the derivatives of even order lying in the same space. In fact, we can replace here E2 of D with the space X delta. The result still holds. So the space E2 of D is smaller than X delta. To prove this result, in fact, we iteratively apply our first argument, and we use the fact that polynomials are reachable, which can be obtained via, let's say, well-known results of Schmidt or by more recent ones of Martin, Rosier, and Rouchon. In fact, we conjecture that we have also an analytic version of this result. So if I take functions which are holomorphic in a neighborhood of D tilde, of D. So these are the functions which have been shown to be reachable in the paper of Dardet and Hervedoza. Then these functions can be reached by controls which are of Jevry type, of Jevry type G2. But up to now, we don't have exactly this result, but we really think it's true. It's for now still a conjecture. So these results are, of course, interesting in their own, but they can also be very interesting for nonlinear problems, because for nonlinear problems, imagine you have a quasi-linear parabolic equation. The fixed point cannot always be done at the level of the L2 spaces. So we need, in order to control the nonlinearities, more smoothness of the control trajectory, so more smoothness of the control. And these kind of results are clearly of great interest in this direction. Let me also mention possible connections with a well-known problem in control of parabolic of the heat equation, which are connected to the control cost in small time. Let us first note that the control cost in some time tau is nothing else than the supremum over all psi in the state space of norm smaller or equal to one of the norm of the semigroup t tau psi, so of the free trajectory. The free solution in the space range of phi tau. So we see that clearly, even at the formal level, that there is a connection between the cost and the space range of phi tau. And so in our case, we can define another constant, which is defined as the supremum over all psi in our space capital X, which here is W minus 1, 2 of 0 pi, the norm t tau of psi, not in range of e tau, but index tau. What does mean index tau? In the space x tau. Let me remind what is x tau. X tau is the sum of those two weighted Bergmann spaces. What we are able to show is that with the above notation, the lim sup when t goes to 0 plus of c tau over d tau is smaller than 1. So if I have a very good estimate on this norm index tau, I might, of yes, of this norm index tau of T tau C, I may hope an improvement of the existing estimates on the control cost in more time, which would be a good advance. Let me remind what does mean this norm index tau, what it is. It is just the norm, the sum of norms of the terms in the decomposition of T tau psi as a sum, as an holomorphic function in one Bermann space to, and plus a function in the second one. So in a way, what we have to optimize is this decomposition. We have been working on that. We have obtained some estimates on the constant d tau, so, but up to now, they are not good enough to improve the best known estimates on c tau. We still hope that this procedure could obtain such an improvement, but this is clearly not a very easy problem. Finally, let's say to answer the question, which of course people would normally ask, what happens in several space dimensions? Very few things are known. So if I take the heat equation in a domain omega, a bounded nice domain omega in Rn, with control on the whole boundary. So it should be here in the second line, so of course, x in partial of, in the boundary of omega on the second on the line. It is a boundary condition. And I define the input maps as previously. So what do we know in this case? There is a very recent result with a surprisingly simple proof, which maybe needs to be more detailed, but which it looks really very nice, of Strohmeyer and Waters, which says, oh, so I forgot here something, that the range of phi tau contains, I should have put before the E of omega bar and capital O of E of omega bar. So these are the functions which are holomorphic in a neighborhood of E of omega. So here the correct writing, I really need at the last moment, I apologize for that, is range of phi tau corresponds a function which are holomorphic in E of omega bar, where what is E of omega? Are the functions, is the set a function of points in Cn, sorry, with x in omega, and y, the modulus of y, smaller than the distance from x to the boundary. So it's a kind of cone in Cn. So here we go to functions of several complex variables, object quite, which at least for me is much less familiar. On this problem, we don't know strictly anything, and I think it's quite complicated, about the behavior, let's say, at the boundary of these holomorphic functions. So do we get something like Bergman spaces of pluricomplex functions, which it's a class of spaces which exist and which are intensively studied in complex analysis of several variables. And also we don't know anything about the situation when the control acts only on a part of the boundary. So I think that with this I have finished my talk, and I'm of course open to all questions.
Okay, can you hear me? Thank you, Marius. So I'm applauding.
Okay.
Is there any? Yeah. Some applause.
I don't hear very well, but
maybe my. Okay, is there any question? So if you have some question, please use the video and the microphone, or otherwise you can put it on the chat, and I will tell it to Marius. Any questions? Okay, so in the meantime, I will ask one question about the... Marius, are you still here?
I'm still here. Do you see me? I can stop the...
That's the way. I don't...
I can stop the, let's say, the sharing. Yeah.
Okay. In fact, I was wondering if you can handle lower order terms, depending on space, say. Or...
I didn't understand very good. Can you repeat?
You handle lower order terms. What can you prove in the case in which you have a potential?
It's a good question, but no, I have been thinking it's not the most difficult thing, but up to now I didn't succeed to include a potential in this approach. Our approach uses a lot, which is our first paper, the fundamental solution of the heat equation and its explicit form. I don't know. I think it's not an extremely difficult issue, but I have not been investigating too long time.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? Okay, I see that no one is putting the microphone in the video. Okay, so